It all depends on ratios. Like, are you banging like 10 strangers to like the same guy 10 times? Or the same guy like 30
So
times?
you're having the same amount of sex.
Oh, but it's different partners compared to one person.
That's
That's
right.
an easy then.
Yeah, I'd
And
say the
you
same.
get paid
The same
for
amount.
one of
Oh,
them
that's an easy one. I'd rather go to the same guy all the time.
that you pay for.
Oh, I pay for him.
He's an escort.
No. Isn't it? I thought you were the escort. You're the.
No, you're a male escort's
Oh,
habitual
so
customer.
you get paid to
So
have
you
sex with
either
multiple people.
or
You
you pay to
pay.
have sex with the same guy all
Oh,
the
I'll
time.
get paid. I'll get railed out by a bunch of guys.
All right, guys, thanks for joining us for another Last Call podcast. My name is Mikey T, joined as always by Tristan.
Hello.
This week we are joined by Sir George, one of the regulars from Diamondback days.
Are you a knight?
Ola.
Are you knighted by the Queen? You didn't tell me that we were having an actual fucking goddamn British knight
We
in
did
here.
get on our knees a lot, so.
Yeah, that's how Diamondback worked back in the day. But anyway, be sure to check our YouTube channel out, youtube.com/MikeyTVersus. And of course, check out the audio versions on Stitcher and iTunes and our website at lastcallpodcast.com. So we just had.
Welcome to the dark world where Donald Trump is president and Tom Brady has five fucking Super Bowl rings.
This is reality.
The
How did it
fucking
come
end
to this?
Is nigh.
I will say, like, I mean, can I, like, I don't know. I just, I can't.
Did you just try to say the word respect and then.
Yeah, and it hurt.
And
I
then
couldn't
change
do
your
it.
mind midway?
So it's like, do I like Tom Brady as a person? No, of course not. He's a douchebag. He's a crybaby. There's nothing to like about him. Can I respect, like, his playing ability? Also no, but like
really?
I don't have to respect it. I can acknowledge it.
Okay. All right, I get that.
He is one of the most unathletic people ever, but he's managed to become a superstar.
It's all science.
So he knows what the fuck he's doing.
He's I mean, he's the GOAT at this point, right? Like full stop, period, greatest of all time, like no argument anymore. We're done with that, right?
I guess so. It's
George, I see the Orioles hat. I'm hoping Ravens fan.
Yeah, it's a Ravens. Definitely Ravens.
Okay, so you have an inborn hatred built over the last several years.
I mean, he's great at what he does, but it's more of a science than anything. And I'm not going to say the Patriots won that game last night. The Falcons lost it. Without a doubt, the Falcons gave that game away, in my opinion.
That was an amazing game. Also, just a terrible game.
I'm hearing that a lot. I'm hearing
them?
The Falcons lost that game. I will say that they made a couple of bad decisions in critical in
not just
in
that,
critical
but a couple
places.
Penalties. A couple penalties did it.
But I mean, you don't give away three touchdowns and a half. Like that's not something like a team the Falcons just do. Like the Patriots definitely earned a part of that. I think the other team making bad decisions is a part in any victory,
especially
right?
With how the defense played in the first half. The Falcons were just shut down in the first half with their defense. And
that's usually what happens, though. Tom Brady figures people out.
And that's what the halftime does to a lot of teams when it comes to the Super Bowl. They were, what, 30, 40 minutes off, you know, and back in the locker room. That can really screw up a team when they're sitting there for that long, especially offense. They said the Patriots had the ball for 40 minutes of regular time. So Matt Ryan was really on the field for 20 minutes. And that can change a game, without a doubt.
Absolutely. Happened to the Ravens, right? Like, everything was going great in the first half, and then it, like, collapsed. Like, if that game had been much longer, they might not have won. Like, you know, it happens all the time. I think the Patriots adjust at the half better than, I mean, obviously almost anybody. I think credit for that goes to Brady and Belichick. I mean, maybe he's not the most athletic quarterback of all time, but He's the fucking best.
I think Tom Brady and Steven Seagal are like a close tie for the girliest
oh my
run.
God.
What?
I agree with that.
Have you ever seen either of them
Steven
run?
Steven Seagal cries. He like wrote a memoir or something about a movie or a script for a movie, and he was reading it and he was crying, and someone goes up to him and was like, what are you crying about? What are you reading? He's like, I just wrote the most beautiful script for a movie ever in my life. Like, this is a true story. This
I'm
is
glad
a,
I didn't see that.
This is
Under Siege would
Neil
never
Brennan,
be the same again.
Neil Brennan said that this story.
Oh, okay.
I heard about that.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. I think personally the Patriots won because of Ray Lewis's pregame speech to him. Have you guys hear that speech?
No, he did his
Ray Lewis did a pregame speech for the Patriots, and he did a lot of wheeze, like, we're gonna get this, and everyone's talking trash on us. I'm like, Ray Lewis, you are not a Patriot. You never were. Like,
I don't think Ray Lewis has any idea what's going on.
He's losing his
given.
Mind. The Patriots made that billboard saying, you know, come to Ray Lewis's retirement party. Like, how are you gonna support a team when they were hardcore bashing you?
Because he has no idea where he is in it. He's taking some hits. He's given some hits, and it's rattled his brain. Do you remember when he was an analyst and he would just start talking, and you're like, no words, like nothing would make sense. It was just jumbled garbage.
I think that's why they released him, because it was just, oh god, it was horrible.
Yeah, I mean, if your job is to talk,
I think he's been full of nonsense for a decade and a half. I think Absolutely. Even when you listen to him on the sidelines, like, he's one of those guys who could just, like, he can shout a fucking bologna sandwich recipe at you and it's going to sound motivational.
Oh,
he's got that thing.
It's passionate garbage.
I think his seriousness would make me laugh. Like, in a lot of serious instances or whatever, like serious moments, if someone was, especially when they preach God on me, I think I would laugh in his face, because I couldn't do it. I really couldn't do it.
I have trouble with that. Like, when somebody's like,
looking you straight in the eyes,
super passionate about, you know, some
religion
tends to be one of those things, and they're just like really into it and really feeling it, and I'm just dying inside, just laughing. I'm like, but I generally don't want to just hurt their feelings for no reason.
Right.
I have to have my reasons for hurting feelings. I'm obviously not against hurting feelings.
Right.
We know that.
I try to be real respectful of that stuff. I try to be, you know, kind of live and let live, you know, especially out in public, like among my friends, it's whatever. But I was in New Orleans one year. I stopped through going to a wedding and I got really hammered, and we were leaving the reception for the night, and we stumbled out onto the street, and we weren't in New Orleans anymore. We'd crossed over into Alabama where the actual wedding was. Anyway, we leave this reception. All three of us are hammered drunk. It's my wife and my buddy Adam. And it's like 1:30 in the morning. We're walking down the road and just rabble-rousing, having a good time. And this guy walks by us all by himself in the middle. I should not have talked to this man. This was dangerous at 1:30 in the morning. And he looks at us. And in my mind, he was holding a Bible in his hand. I don't know if that was actually true. But he turns to us as we pass by and he says, "Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord of Savior, his Lord and Savior?" And drunk as hell, I turn around as I walk by that man and I look him in the eyes and I say, "Jesus Christ was a fictional fucking character."
He just shattered that guy's whole worldview.
And then he's like, "No, I can tell you how." And he like holds his book and he starts walking back towards me. And that's when my wife and Adam tackle me and like start dragging me. "We're really sorry. He didn't mean that. Like, he doesn't mean." I was ready to go back and argue with him. Just like,
that's probably something I would do.
That's absolutely something you would do.
But then I'd probably strip naked and go, "Woo! God gave me this."
That's what I love about you. You're absolutely insane, but then somehow also very well put together. You bought a house fairly young and all this other stuff.
Yeah, I tell people that all the time. I'm a very immature person, but when I know when I have to be serious and I know when I have to be mature, and I act upon that. But I know when I can have fun, and I like to entertain everybody. Nowadays, social media, everything, everybody is only doing things for attention. I'm not gonna deny that I do things for, you know, everyone does.
Well, most people don't take pictures of themselves naked with a pumpkin in front of their junk
or
just
Doritos
for the hell
bags.
Of it.
Hey, man, those are some good pictures.
That's like your holiday card every year.
Yeah. I should do a Valentine's Day one next week.
I heard that once, perhaps more than once, at Diamondback Tavern, you took a shot and stapled a dollar to your forehead and squeezed a lime into your eye? Is that like
okay,
a thing?
I had a feeling. Eyes, maybe? I had a feeling this was going to come up. Okay, so
what's it called again?
When we were younger, do you remember doing a strikeout?
Not off the top of my head.
Okay, so strikeout was where you took a hit of weed, you keep the smoke in, you take a shot, chug a beer, blow the smoke out. You're supposed to keep it in. Okay.
Right.
So then later on, you know, well, I haven't smoked weed in years, but that was how that thing was. And then later on, there's other drinks that I learned. And I met Mikey during the huge Inception bomb stage. So like the thing was, like, every time I came to the Diamondbacks, when I first met Mikey, I was Inception bomb. This kind of stuff.
Okay.
And then I learned other ones.
So for people that don't know, the Inception bomb is like a four-layer bomb.
A drink inside a drink inside a drink.
Exactly. So I don't even remember how it starts. So you start, you pull a shot of tequila, and it drops
a bomb.
Yeah.
Like a cherry bomb, whatever bomb you want.
Yeah, we would mix it up, and then it would drop a bomb. And then when you pulled the bomb out to do that, it would drop Crown and Amaretto.
It was like a breakfast bomb or whatever.
Yeah,
with orange juice.
Yeah, it was like Crown and Amaretto into orange juice and light beer.
Yeah.
And then you chug like half a pitcher of... I mean, it must have been 10 drinks. And
oh, it will mess you up.
Full retail, what's an Inception bomb cost?
What were we charging, like 25 or 30?
I don't remember.
We sort of made it up every time.
Yeah, it was kind of just one of those things like...
It probably should have cost a lot more.
We'll push a few buttons. So then there was another drink that my buddy introduced me to, which is a suicide tequila, which was you snort a line of, you know, like not a lemon drops, but like
yeah,
a tequila shooter with the
backwards.
Salt in the lime.
Yeah.
So you snort a line of salt, take the shot of tequila, squeeze a lime in your eye. So then I kind of did the strikeout and that in a, like a mixture, combined it. So the normal thing I would do would be do the smoke. But obviously in a bar, you can't do that.
Right.
So I would do the suicide tequila. So I'd do the salt, the shot, the lime. And then I would do a flaming Dr. Pepper, which is amaretto and 151. You light it on fire, drop mm-hmm. it in a beer, you chug it. And then since I didn't do the weed or whatever, I was like, well, it's not official strikeout because it's only two things. So I would take a stapler, and I wouldn't do a single dollar bill. I usually do 20s because I'm high class, you know? And then I would staple it to my head, and for some odd reason, the entire bar would freeze when this was happening, and they would all watch me, and the entire bar freaked out. And there was like one, I think the final night of Diamondbacks, there was probably like five or six phones just on me recording it, and everyone was like, yo, you're so stupid. I was like, I know.
I've accepted that.
But it's whatever.
Mikey's right. You seem so well put together.
Thank you.
Who hurt you?
That's for another day. We don't have enough time for that. No.
It's like we're gonna need a second hour to the podcast.
I've seen counselors for this.
I just realized this is the first podcast that I'm back to drinking.
Yeah, that's right.
And I haven't
Mikey's
had a fucking
back on
drink
the wagon.
Yet. Oh. What am I
you're
doing?
Just not used, you're just not used to it. You just got to get back.
It's
know.
Just sitting there, and I was like, why am I not drinking that? What the hell's wrong with it? I'm off
it's
my
a good
game,
pour.
Man.
It's
if, I'd, if I'd known George was coming, I'd have brought two bottles of Amaretto and
right.
Some 151,
right
a lighter, a stapler, and a $100 bill, and we'd have had us a fucking episode.
Sorry,
it's so
balls.
Good when it hits your lips.
Oh, God.
I don't know what they do over the other show. Can we smoke weed in your basement? Is it three strike? Is that a... Is
oh,
that
God.
Last week, Mike Chappell, he asked, he's like, yo, can I blaze there?
Oh, God. I haven't seen Chappell in a while.
Yeah, I haven't put the video up yet, but he was on last week. But I was like, no, you can't smoke weed in my basement.
Like, sounds like
rule
him.
Of thumb. You cannot smoke in places where there are now baby children.
Yeah.
Like, that's just, you know.
Generally speaking.
Just a rule of thumb, you know.
Yeah, Child Services came after me when I was young. I told them that my brother beat me up, so that's to the other story we were talking about. We don't have time for... No, I'm joking.
It's like we're just going down a dark road. Good luck, everybody.
That's what we do here. It happens occasionally.
As long as you don't have any domestic violence stories, that's what we're trying to get.
Oh, no, 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 no. Don't have that. I do date a therapist, so she's helping me a little bit.
It helps when I hit her. Oh. Get the anger out.
That's where a couple people would have led that story.
So we normally do this segment later, but since we're on the topic, I am curious, is there an alcohol that you will no longer drink? And if so, why?
Oh, I drink everything.
Yeah, I kind of thought that was coming. Yeah.
Well, actually, no. Okay, correction. I will not drink Four Loko or juice anymore. Once I took the caffeine out, it would just turn to garbage.
Okay.
So that's a simple answer.
Because it's not good.
It's not good anymore.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Was that shit actually good?
Oh, God. Yeah. It was the best pregame thing. I would drink like one or two of those before I went to a party, and I was a lightweight afterwards. Because that thing would mess you up.
I tried one. I think it was after they took all the
caffeine
extra
out.
Shit out.
It was garbage.
But it just tasted like bad wine. Like
or like cough syrup.
Yeah. It was, yeah. I don't know. It tasted really bad. So I didn't understand what the...
Yeah, and so no good story there for, like, you were hoping, like, I puked my guts out for, like, hours or something like that.
Hope is a strong word, but typically, you know, it's I did something stupid or...
I'm sure you still got plenty of those.
Oh, I got plenty of those, but I'll still drink anything.
None that were stupid enough that would... or nothing that affected what you would drink.
Yes,
yeah. I guess is. No, do you have any liquor you just don't like? You'd avoid if you had the option. Is there just stuff you don't like? Because I'm sort of the same way. I'll drink everything, but
it's not really for the whole whether it tastes bad or it does certain or like I just had bad stories with it. But certain alcohols, well, I'm allergic to alcohol actually. I still drink, and I think was that you that I've talked to you about, or was it somebody else? I break out in hives. Certain alcohols do it. Certain nights do it. It's weird. I've never really been able to put my finger on it.
Okay.
I can drink the same liquor one night and then another night, and I'll have two different... It will do different things to me. One night I'll be perfectly fine. The next night I'll be feeling like I'm in a sauna, like it's 150 degrees, and I'll be completely red, broken out in hives, and itchy, and I'm freaking out. But
That's got to put a damper on a night.
Well, no. If I stop drinking for 20, 30 minutes, it usually starts going away. But it's just really weird.
That is weird.
Yeah. I'm not the only one who... God,
Did you just quit drinking again?
Yeah. knock on wood.
I'm not the only one. That, like, the main things that really did it to me were like Jaeger or... I don't know. It's not beer. It's usually just liquor. But it's certain things do it to me different nights. I don't know if it's... the speed I drink or the amount I drink at a certain time or
the dollar bill that just stapled to your head.
Yeah, it's weird.
So do you still go out and drink like that on occasion, or are you kind of past that phase?
What, like heavy drinking?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like
not
drinking
as much as
10
I used
drinks
to.
In one, like, but you're still kind of...
Honestly, it's weird to see me drinking on a work night.
That's kind of where I was getting at. Like, I was kind of, you know, like... There's these wild stories of you drinking 20 drinks in one.
Weekends.
Juxtaposed with a guy who, when Mikey offered him a second beer, was like, no, I'm good.
I'm a weekend warrior.
Yeah, I'm impressed.
I used to definitely, when I was younger, I used to go out almost every night and drink and go to sleep at like 1 in the morning and wake up at 5 or whatever and go
right,
to work.
Right.
But about... 10 years ago, I got an injury at work, and I didn't drink the night before, and I didn't do any drugs the night before, and my hand fell in a machine, and it was a very severe accident, and if I had been drunk or on any sort of drug or anything, you know, workers' comp, and all that insurance isn't going to cover you.
Wouldn't have paid anything.
Yeah, exactly. So after that, that's the day I started maturing a little bit more, and I was like, maybe this isn't a good idea, because I was out of work for 3 months, so I was getting paid through the insurance agency for being off, and I still went back to the job. I'm still there to this day, and then I got a settlement afterwards of a pretty penny, which actually helped me get to where I am today with buying the house.
Sure.
So if I was drunk that or any sort of alcohol or anything, I'd have been screwed. So it was at that point I was like, maybe I shouldn't drink the nights before work.
Yeah.
Just to be safe.
Yeah.
So does your settlement allow you to talk about your horrible injury that I'm intensely curious about?
I mean, it's a shut case, and this is 10 years ago.
So what happened?
Is a joiner. Do you know what a joiner is when it comes to woodworking? Pretty much, it's a blade, maybe yay round, and it's got a couple blades, and I don't even know how fast it goes, but it shreds. So you take a piece of wood, mm-hmm. and it's got a bow in it, and you just run it across it until you get it flat.
Okay.
And you know, so if you're thinking it's cutting wood, so it just and making it flush, and it's got a smooth, it's making that end of the wood smooth, what can it do to the skin and flesh? Sure. And people are like, well, did you get that part of your hand back? I'm like, no, it's dust.
It's gone.
And there was no blood. It was like it just sucked it all in, and there was like a
So you ran your hand over that.
Well, my hand, it was a twisted piece, and my hand just slipped off and fell right in. And it, I mean, my joiner's taken my boss's finger twice. Same finger, fell in twice, similar guy's finger. So it happens a lot.
It's just one of those things. So it took a chunk of your hand.
Yeah.
And there's no blood?
I mean, it was a splat of blood.
Right.
And then I blacked out. I went in the shock.
Really?
So, yeah.
Yeah. Hospital, ambulance. And then I had to get surgery. What's repair like that for something like
that? Skin graft.
Okay.
They had to bump it out a little bit, and it was really nasty.
Oh, so it like took a good like chunk out of it.
Yeah, I'll show
it.
You
like,
pictures you later. Like... It was the whole side of my hand was black for a while. It was all dead skin and
wow.
It was pretty it's gnarly.
can you like feel it or you
Oh,
like...
for a, well, what after it, the wrap came off, my hand was stuck like well, my I don't even think Mikey knows this. My hand was stuck like this. So
yeah, it's kind of funny.
For the audio listeners, it looks like he's doing.
I don't mean to
laugh.
I'm sure that was horrible. But...
It looks like he's doing like a shadow puppet dog.
Yeah,
is the best way I can describe that.
It's the hand motion that people make when they're making fun of mentally challenged people.
Pretty
much. That's what it is.
You did the Donald Trump thing.
Did I? Oh,
no, that's
pretty
good,
much how my
that's
hand was.
That's down. Exactly what it was. Yeah, you're
so,
right.
Yeah, my hand was stuck like that, so I had to go to physical therapy 2 times a week for I don't even remember how long, and just slowly work it, and you know.
But it's like it's 100% now.
Oh yeah, it's fine. It's actually better than this hand is now. So
would you do it again to the other hand?
For the settlement
they gave you.
No, well, this hand's had worse issues than that. Me,
oh really?
Me and Mikey are broken hand partners, so.
Oh, yeah, I see.
So it was around the same time too, right?
You were a year before me, just about.
That's right.
Yeah.
How'd you break your hand?
Well, you had a good story.
He did.
My first one wasn't good. I've broken it twice. Broke right here, middle finger.
Mm-hmm.
I was at the Phoenix and I grabbed a chair and it just popped. And when I went to the specialist, he said he thinks it was a benign tumor that just popped.
What?
Yeah, how crazy is that?
Because I
didn't
do
anything.
Something that could happen.
I just grabbed. Well, you were there that night.
I remember you saying that now.
Yeah, but I just.
So you grabbed it and it.
I just grabbed a chair like that and it just popped. It
terrible
just broke.
Pain, like.
I was no, my finger was discombobulated. It was just all over the place. I was just like,
yeah,
oh.
I remember that because you walked.
Because you're
you were all like.
Yeah, because it was your friend. Who was the nurse that was there?
I don't remember.
She was like, your hand's broken. I was like, oh, it's just dislocated. I'm fine. And she was like, no, you should really go to the hospital. It's broken. No, 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 no. And then the next day I went. I was like, oh, crap. And then last year we were at MAGFest. Do you guys know MAGFest?
I don't. Yeah,
that's at music and
the
gaming festival.
Yeah, Gaylord. It is amazing. If you're huge into like old school arcade games and cosplay and board games and all that, you gotta go. It is the best thing
I'm
ever.
I'm not huge in any of those things, but I'm interested enough in all of those things that might be.
Well, if you get the weekend pass early, it's like $50 for the
weekend.
I've
been meaning to go for years.
Let's go next year. Mikey, let's go next year. We'll get a hotel room in the Gaylord. We'll drink all weekend.
Wait, when is it?
It's usually February, but this year they bumped it up early. It was the first weekend of January.
Oh.
So I think it was.
I was going to say, because it's usually around.
They bumped it early.
Should have gone. That would have been
amazing.
Yeah,
they bumped it a little bit early this year.
Oh, those fuckers.
Yeah.
All right, next year.
Next year. I'm going to go every other year. So there's a lot of all of that. So there's that game called Sneaky Cards. You guys know it?
No.
I have it. But like it's a lot of things like you leave this card at a monument or this or that. Well, I killed 3/4 of a handle of Captain Morgan White Rum that day. So you
I'm
know,
disappointed that you chose the white rum, but that's okay. Beyond that, we can move past.
It's a good start.
So you guys know what state I'm in.
Yep.
So I'm a little passing out a little bit, and someone hits me with a sneaky card, and it's the card that says, "Go in an elevator, recite a speech, and the last person on the elevator, give that card to." As drunk as I am, I'm doing it. So I go on the elevator, and what speech would you guys pick if you were in that situation?
Fuck, I don't know.
Independence Day. Bill Pullman. I freaking looked it
I
up.
I couldn't even think of a speech off of the top of my head.
Yeah, I could barely speak. I was so drunk. I was slurring my words. But I get that damn speech off, and there's probably five people in the elevator, and they are staring at me like, what the hell is this drunk guy doing?
Was there somebody there with you as a witness?
Oh, I had friends with me, but they got off on a lower level.
So, I was going to say, you must have looked like an absolute lunatic. Just...
I would assume it was a Bill Pullman disguise than just hanging around the Gaylord.
So I'm waiting, and there's only so many levels, and this girl is the last one, and door opens, and I give it to her, and she looks at it, and she reads it. She says, oh, hell no, and she throws it back at me, and I pick it up. I'm said, no, you're taking this. So I'm chasing her down the hall. And
wait, what is she supposed to do with it?
I don't know. I guess she's supposed to take it and redo it. Redo the same thing. She was the last one on the elevator. I was drunk. I don't know.
It's like, I could barely make it through my speech.
Yeah. Okay. I was.
But you decided to chase her down a hallway.
So I was chasing her. Barely. I could barely stand. And I'm running after this girl in a narrow hallway and the Gaylord.
There's no way that looks bad.
Yeah, exactly.
Take this card, bitch.
Get back here. People staring at me, and I took the turn in the hallway, and my hand just hit the corner of a wall, and it just popped, and I fell to the ground. I was like, damn.
Same position, different
place. It was about an inch away from the last break. Yeah.
Oh, same bone, just a different spot.
This was the first one, and then the knuckle was the second one. So
is that finger still kind of fucked up?
Oh yeah, yeah. Look at my.
It's got like a curve to it.
Yeah, look
right?
at my knuckles. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Wow. Yeah. You're like knuckle. You're missing a knuckle.
Yeah, and
that's
then my
that's amazing.
And I was like, I can't get in fights anymore. And then Diamondback's final night, I got in a huge fist fight. Not in the bar. Southpaw. Not in the bar.
Memories. Yeah. Jesus.
So that's my story. That's my life story. Sorry, guys.
You wanted domestic violence. I thought we were getting there. I thought he was gonna. No. I thought.
It's like, so I hit this bitch so hard.
I grabbed her by the ankle. She fell down. I stuffed the card in her mouth and said, "It's yours now," and ran away.
I would let you guys beat me up if I ever hit a girl. So, just to make that clear.
Oh, jeez. We're not kidding though. That's how a few stories went, and we were both just sort of sitting here like. Waiting for like the punchline.
What, the people on this podcast?
Yeah.
Oh wow, I'm better than other people. Woo.
Well, I mean,
it's still early.
Yeah.
We're only halfway through the night. You've got plenty of time.
Still time to fuck this up.
Like when somebody starts telling a story, that's one of the problems with just giving people free rein to tell whatever they want. It's like we don't know. We often don't know where that story is going, and sometimes it goes to a horrible place, and we're just kind of along for the ride, because it's like, you're waiting for that punchline or whatever the point
this
of the story
be...
where it gets, like, funny, or it's, oh, yeah, it's a joke, whatever.
Funny
and
story
sometimes
is this is
it never
evidence.
Gets there.
This is being recorded. So.
Oh, yeah, this goes onto the internet, this fucking lives forever. Yeah. NSA will catalog this and put it in your file, and yeah.
I've never been arrested, so I'm not trying to do that.
Yeah, we're memorable.
all the old Ellicott City stories that I have.
So we were briefly talking about Super Bowl and everything. A lot of people their favorite thing about the Super Bowl commercials. What did you guys think? I barely got to catch them. I was working the whole time, but the ones I saw, I didn't see. I feel like the last. 5 Super Bowls or so, there haven't been.
Well, Doritos announced a few months ago that they were out this year because they wanted to take a year off. But it's funny because the last 2 or 3 years, they haven't even made commercials. They're doing the $1 million fan commercial, which they have all those people make commercials, and then they pick the best ones and put them on.
Oh, that's right.
So they didn't
do it.
They
had the time machine thing.
Yeah, that was from Ellicott City or this area.
Yeah, that was somewhere local.
The time machine, if I remember correctly. So they didn't do it. Pepsi didn't do any. Budweiser's not funny anymore. They're more serious.
Yeah, they've had the real serious ones the last few times.
Yeah, and those were the three best ones back in the day.
They're in trouble this year. People are pissed about their new commercial because everybody thinks it's about the wall or the immigration. So
they made it months ago, though.
Yeah.
That's the thing that I don't understand.
You can't make a commercial in a month. The last month.
No.
And even if they did, it really doesn't. I don't know. It's a German immigrant coming to the country legally and starting Budweiser. Like, what does that have to do with any of the controversy in politics right now? It doesn't. They're just grasping at straws.
It was a lot less political than I thought it was going to be, and I'm glad about that.
Yeah, people were trying to make it into something that's not.
Like the Super Bowl proper?
No, I'm just saying, a lot of people thought Gaga was going to make the halftime show very political, and it wasn't political at all.
Yeah, no, I agree. She stayed away from
it. The only controversy about the halftime show was that it was pre-taped, that when she was on the roof.
Yeah, that was disappointing, but as soon as I thought about it for 30 seconds, I was like,
but she got away.
Cares?
She said months ago that when she was first announced, she wanted to do it on the roof. So I'm glad, and the drones were awesome. The drones
were
really
rad.
Cool. Yeah.
Took me a minute to figure out what I was looking at.
I thought they were balloons.
Like, yeah, the drones were really cool. I don't know. The fact that they fake opened up the roof kind of seems
Actually, they said that during the Super Bowl that they opened the roof for the halftime.
They did, but they opened the roof so that she could not actually be up there.
Yeah.
I guess maybe she jumped from up there to come down on the wires, but yeah, no, that was fun. That was a fun halftime show. Lady Gaga is one of those people who I want to hate with every fiber of my being.
I want to hate her in bed.
But I can't.
I want to hate her in bed and beat her. That's my domestic abuse that I want to do.
There we are.
Yeah, we know.
Ding, count it.
Oh, God.
No, she's so talented, and she's so, if you listen to her interview, she's really genuine and just, she's not, all of her stuff isn't super weird because she's, seeking attention.
Yeah.
All of her stuff is super weird because she's just fucking super weird.
And her past is dark, but she's where she is now because of how messed up her past was.
Yeah, she works really hard, and she just really loves her dad, and it's fucking irritating.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad.
Irritates the piss out of me.
You're so boring.
Oh, my God.
My buddy sent me a link last night. He's like, did you know Lady Gaga was in Boiling Point on MTV however many years ago? And he sends me a link, and I watch it. I was like, holy crap, that's Lady Gaga. And holy crap.
Was that thing where they just pretended to not get mad?
Where they gave you the time. They were like, if this person makes it this long without getting mad at what's going on, they win. She was in a restaurant, and they were like, they took her food away when she went to the bathroom, and she was like, I'd like it back. And they brought it back with a used napkin on it. And she was like, what the hell?
I remember seeing that show, and it was terrible.
It was bad.
I did not know that she was on it, though. That's kind of neat. Mm-hmm. When you see, that's kind of cool when you go back and you see celebrities before they're famous and that
before
shit.
They popped. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's really fun.
That's about the only exciting thing to come out of MTV's Boiling Point.
Yeah.
Or any of their reality television, for that matter.
I was at a banquet over the weekend, and for our last drinks of the night, at 10 o'clock, the thing was closing at 10:30, Susan and I got Maker's Mark on the rocks, and I paid, better part of $20 for it at this banquet thing. And so we got them, and then we got back to our table, and we put down these half-full tumblers of Maker's Mark, and we put them down on our table. And then they started playing a song, and Susan wanted to go dance. So I was like, all right, we'll put them down on the table, and then we went and danced. And we came back, and the waitstaff had taken our drinks.
Oh, God.
And I was like, oh, man, that's really irritating. And then I went to the bar, and I was like, hey, we put our full drinks down on the tables, and the guys took them. And the bar manager was there, and he was like, well, you know what? You guys were supposed to, be out of here a half hour ago. So, as a courtesy, they're saying they took all the drinks. So we're really sorry, but there's nothing I can do. I almost just flipped the bar top over and started stabbing people.
I would have done all that except for the stabbing.
I absolutely would have put that guy in the hospital.
Oh, without a doubt.
Yeah. You absolutely
were the bottles of liquor still out behind the bar?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, I would have jumped over the bar and just started down. And
this is mine now. Call the cops.
Yeah.
I almost
try to take this from me. Right. I dare you.
Yeah. I didn't give a shit that it happened. Mistakes happen, but don't be a dick about it.
Yeah. You could even just say you're not allowed to, or something. Pretend you're not the bar manager.
Right. Yeah, don't pour me a drink if it's gonna get like snatched with 2 minutes or 3 minutes later.
And this was after the same hotel. So we check into the hotel and they put us into this room out in the newly renovated wing. And our room is literally 8 inches from the ice machine for the floor, right?
Oh, no.
There's no separation, no doorway. The ice machine is outside of our door. And so I call the front desk and I'm like, hey, I'm really, you know, if you could, the ice machine's right outside of our room. Do you have anything else? Like, we're not picky. Like, I'll pay for an upgrade. Like, what do you need? Like, where can we go? She's like, we're pretty close to sold out. Let me see what I can do. And I sit on hold and tippity tap. And then she's like, okay, I think I got one for you. It's in another section of the hotel. Now you can't look out over the golf course. You're going to be looking at the parking lot. It's lower down. Is that okay? I was like, yeah, I don't care. As long as it's, you know, it's fine. It's great. So we wait 45 minutes for the bellhop to come. And he gives us our new card. And we go to another building in the hotel. And down three floors to the room that overlooks the parking lot to find that we're next to the other fucking ice machine.
What the fuck?
I was so pissed.
I would lose my mind. That's probably the reason I don't travel very often, because there's always... I mean, you're bound to run into shit like that. Like, shit happens. And the average person is a fucking idiot.
Yeah.
And that's in every job, every position. So you're going to run into some idiots. And when you're out of your own zone, you have less control.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like,
And you said it. Tell me no. We're really sorry. We're booked up. I can't move you. Don't fucking make me a big production of me moving all my shit down to the other ice machine. Fuck you. And then the next morning, I'm hungover from drinking the night before. And I'm like, they were like, how was your stay? Was everything fantastic? And I'm like, actually, no, it wasn't. Here's what happened. And so I tell my story and she's like, oh, I'm really sorry. That'll be $129.99. Like, fuck you. No discount. No, like, here's a coupon for a future stay. Just like, oh, that sucks.
It's like, toss me a bottle of water. Get something. Yes. Hey, but you would have felt even worse if you had that extra Maker's Mark.
Oh, no. I got my fucking Maker's Mark back from that bartender, just so we're clear.
Oh, okay.
I didn't give a fuck when I was supposed to be out there. He had my $20. I was getting my Maker's Mark. I didn't have to stab anybody, fortunately.
Yeah, thankfully.
But no,
yeah.
I got that drink. That was why I was hungover the next day.
Generally speaking, it's good if you can make it through the night without stabbing somebody.
Because it was like a 19-year-old that poured the drink, so it was legitimately just like a half tumbler of Maker's Mark with some ice in it. Like, I mean, it was delicious, but it was definitely not how you're supposed to pour that.
God, it is strange when you see different places that have, you know, different levels of pour or people that just don't know. So if you have an inexperienced bartender, or if you're at a wedding or an event where they're not real bartenders. And they have no idea what they're doing.
You can ask.
That can go one way or the other. So
you can ask anyone I go to the bars with. If I'm getting a mixed drink or cocktail or whatever, I'll get a drink and my eyes are glued to them and I count their pour. And if it's a good pour, I will continue getting cocktails. If it's an okay pour, I will also. But if it's a horrible pour, I'm going the beer. I'm sorry. Like, if you do, like, a three or four count on your pour, like a 1, 2, 3, 4, you are not getting my $5, $6, $7 for a drink. It's, no, definitely not.
Yeah, switch over, get the guaranteed amount.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
Nobody's going to fuck up popping a beer.
Because I pour, I'm not going to say great, I pour great. I pour great. I'm sorry. I'm just going to throw it out there. But I also don't want 95% alcohol, 5% soda, because it's just overwhelming. I want a good, like, 60-40. So that's how I pour my drinks. I'll do a good 60% alcohol, 40% soda, or mixer.
Sure.
That's a great drink.
I will say one of the most frustrating things at being in Nottingham's for a while now, the crowd has just changed, and everybody wants something for free. Everybody wants Long Islands. They can't taste the liquor.
That's my issue, is you have the people, and it's like, I can't taste any alcohol in there. I'm like, that means it was made perfect.
Yeah, that's what I was like. If it's made correctly, you can't.
Because
and it still has a shit ton of liquor.
If there's not enough alcohol in it, then it's just too much sour mix.
Yeah. It just drives me nuts. Like, they're just looking for handouts. I'm not making drinks for you the way you make them in your college dorm room. Like, if you pay for a shot, I'll give you a shot. Nottingham's already pours a half ounce above what a standard shot is. And so I started pouring that, and because of just how it is, and it's you pour that, and that's not enough, and then you're just constantly dealing with either people won't or complaining, and then you got to fix drinks and remake stuff, and it's just not worth it. So you just pour a little, have to go a little bit heavier. So it's like you're pouring, like, you know,
still don't tip
at least 2 ounces. Yeah. Well, I will say it's like it's a decent mixture there. So generally, when somebody rolls up and it looks like they have tin foil on their teeth,
oh god,
you're not getting anything from that guy.
Don't bother.
Yeah, I'll make my liquor cross back on that person. Cause...
Being a bartender, you can definitely like psychoanalyze people, without a doubt.
Absolutely.
Well, not mentally, but when it comes to the wallet, you can analyze people.
Absolutely. Well, and that's true, but you don't want to act on it.
No. Because you want to treat everybody equally.
Which is one thing that people struggle with in the bar industry, is you'll see they just automatically judge someone like, oh, this guy looks like a fucking hoodlum and he's not going to tip. And then that guy might tip fucking fantastic, but now he won't because you treated him like shit.
Yep.
And it's like...
Or say we're working on a house or something like that, and we got dirty clothes, whole clothes, we got our beards, we got paint in our face or whatever. We go to a bar, we look really crappy. They're going to be like, well, these are some homeless bums coming in here. They're not going to tip us, even though I think I tip pretty well. You tip pretty well. Obviously, being a bartender, you tip well. And that's why I tip the amount that I do. They would pretty much ignore us or treat us lesser than people who are in a suit or a nice dress or something like that. The white collar people.
I will say, like, white collar people that look like they have money, generally speaking, are some of the worst tippers.
Oh yeah. I was at a bar with my girl's boss last week, and she makes great money. And she was she did a couple of the, what are they called? You don't get a glass of wine, you get it in a little thingy. What are those called?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Where it's like two glasses of wine and you pour it in. You don't know what I'm talking about.
I'm not sure.
I don't know what they're called. Yeah, like I guess
like a wine craft, where it's a little separate thing.
Yeah.
It looks like
in your glass,
like a vase for flowers.
Yes, that.
Yeah.
And she got like three or four of those, and she tipped like $2.50. And I was like Shannon. I was like, your boss is a horrible tipper. And she's like, yeah, she's rich. What do you expect? I was like, ah, damn.
I mean,
you have money by keeping money.
Yeah,
that's true. I was just gonna say that. I mean, it's sad, but I mean, that's one thing that's tough in the bar industry, because I feel like all the bartenders we're just passing around the same like $20-$30. Like,
oh god, yeah.
It's like we're coming in getting like two beers and a shot, and then tipping $20, and then that next person goes to another bar and gets two beers and a shot and passes that on.
A lot of people don't realize when they have coupons or Groupons or Living Social, all those things, and say they get $20 off, they don't realize they're supposed to tip on the original amount.
Yeah.
And I have a thing where when I go to a place, I'm 20% starting off. I start off, you're getting 20% no matter what. If you have better service...
Yeah,
you're going up.
You get like a hookup or whatever.
Yeah, but I'm starting you off at 20% no matter what. If it's just normal routine, if you don't screw up or you're not better. You're getting 20%.
Yeah.
When there's people like a certain skinny girl who you remember back in the day.
Oh, that one bitch.
Yeah, well, I don't remember if I told you this. She's now a webcam girl. Did I tell you this? Oh, she's haggard. She's a webcam girl. I forget where she's living now, but it is. She's not.
She looks like somebody that would be on 16 and pregnant.
But she also has
my favorite.
She also has a
like Janelle.
She also has a tattoo that says "Every rose has a thorn." And the song came on when we were at the bar years ago, and she's like, "I love Guns N' Roses," and I'm just like, "Why am I hanging out with this girl?" I'm just like, oh God, get me away from her. It's nice to see that certain girls that you may have been interested in are webcam girls, and you're like, ha, didn't miss out there.
Dodge that bullet.
Mikey hated her.
Oh, she was a mess.
She'd come for like the dollar girl night, and she wouldn't tip anything.
Would you, in an alternate universe where, you know, Christina died when she was young and you never met her, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Would you date somebody who was like a stripper? Maybe not a full-on hooker, but a stripper.
No.
Would you hook up with a stripper?
No. I hate hookers.
Hard no.
I hate hookers. I hate strippers.
Not even like what if like you met a girl at a bar, right? Or just out and about, and she seemed super cool, and everything was, you know, you hung out with her a couple of times, and she seemed super well adjusted, okay? She's never lied about what she did. She seemed super well adjusted. You two are getting along really well. And then on date three, she's like, "I gotta be honest, I am a stripper." Would you continue to date her?
Nope. So my ex, not at all. My ex was a hairdresser, and then I was talking to, this is all obviously long before Christina and I got together, but it was like I was talking to this other girl, and I found out she was a hairdresser, and I dropped her because she was a hairdresser. I was like, nope, not doing that again. That bitch was a psycho. No fucking way.
So no hairdressers and no strippers.
Yep. Hard no on those.
Never dated a stripper, but I've definitely hooked up with a couple. Not gonna lie. And then there was a couple. Well, the couple, they wanted to date me, and I'm like, I'm not dating you. You're
so
a
no.
Stripper.
So no dating a stripper. Is it because of the mental instability?
I don't want a girl to come home to me who has been rubbing up on other guys for a living.
Okay.
I mean, that makes sense.
It's as simple as that. But then that's the same reason I don't like strip clubs. I don't understand the appeal.
But that's true.
I'll tell you, if you ever go to Atlanta, there's a strip club called the Claremont Lounge in Five Points. Have you ever been to Atlanta?
No.
Okay, well, if you ever go, hit me up.
go to this amazing thing that I do
not
like.
No, it's the worst thing. It's the worst thing ever. So it's this little dive bar, and it's a strip club. But it is old haggard women. They're in their 50s, 60s. They're fat. They're nasty. It is the worst thing ever. But it is the best thing ever.
I thought they banned circuses.
Oh, God.
Didn't Barnum and Bailey close down?
No, they're closing
down,
yeah. But let me tell you, you have a 50% chance of running celebrities. Jennifer Lawrence is always there. Keith Sutherland. Jason Momoa. The Jonas Brothers were just there. Leonardo DiCaprio goes there. Let me tell you. Because it is a tourist trap in Atlanta. And there's a... Atlanta is the number three market right now in the country for movies being filmed there. So with all the movies being filmed in Atlanta, you have a great shot at meeting a celebrity in the Claremont Lounge in Atlanta.
I missed something. So it's a tourist trap?
No, well, not for everyone.
For aging strippers?
Okay,
like
they say it's where strippers go to die.
Strippers?
They say it's where strippers go to die, but it's funny. It's more of a... You want a good
it's
laugh?
It's a sideshow.
Yeah, it's a sideshow. That's a good term for it.
Ugh.
But there's a lot of celebrities in Atlanta, so they go there, and I go there for the laugh. It's a dive bar. It's like $3 bushes or Natty Lights or whatever.
I will say I've heard strip clubs having some crazy specials. There was a
Monday
was
nights
Scores I think was doing
Fantasies as dollar beers on Monday.
I think it was Scores had like Sunday nights. It was like.
open bar.
It's like all you can drink for like 2 hours for like $20.
Yeah.
Like
it's because no one goes out that night.
All you can drink everything.
I guess they get you liquored up enough they get your money one way or another, right? Like they either get it at the bar or they get it in the back. Like
if you go there on a normal night, Scores is also $8 for a 12-ounce bottle of beer.
Oh yeah, no, I believe
they make money.
No, absolutely. Yeah. I believe that. But like on like a Sunday night, like if nobody's out there, you know, paying a $20 cover and $8, like get them in for, you know.
I think last year Toro had a happy hour. It was a Tuesday night and no one wanted to go. And I showed up for a little bit and no cover. It was open bar. It wasn't like the high end, but it was, you know.
Everything but top shelf, I guess.
Yeah. And it was a no one was there except for us and we were drinking. So I wasn't complaining.
It's rad. Yeah.
I would actually do that.
Why didn't you go?
Because I don't like strip clubs.
Oh, yeah, you did say that. My bad.
Because, I mean, I'd go for just because it's frugal.
We were barely paying attention to the girls. We were just drinking.
That's the thing. I don't find that entertaining. I will never understand the appeal of sitting with a bunch of other guys and watching girls get naked. It doesn't seem like a group activity to me.
Kind of like sitting around watching porno, like together.
Oh yeah, like you're gonna
fucking
have a
weird.
Fat
There's
party
always
with
that
your
one
guy
weird
friends.
Person no, that does that shit.
No, I guess I get that. Like I'll go to a strip club all day with a bunch of guys, and watch girls get naked on a stage, and that's fun to me. But if we watch the same thing on videotape in a room on a couch together, then it's super weird.
Well, Scores,
which is a completely. You know, there's no reason for that differentiation, but it's definitely different.
See, because best case scenario, I go to a strip club. I'm not giving any money. I'm not going to waste their time. I'm not going to lead them on thinking I'm going to give them money. But it's like, I'm not doing them any favors. And worst case scenario, I'm hammered and I'm yelling inappropriate shit at them. Because
your father didn't love you.
Like, no tits, no ass. Fuck this place.
That's a horrible tattoo. Why is half your head shaved?
I feel like oftentimes that haircut is just you're a step away.
I hate it.
The half shaved haircut.
Yeah. Oh, you got one foot in the proverbial stripper grave.
My favorite is the one. It's it's like the high cut bob haircut. That's like, you've got brown roots, but like blonde at the end. They call it the "Can I speak to your manager?" Yeah.
Or the Dixon actually shared that on one of our friends' pages, and it said the "I'm white, but my kids aren't" haircut.
Oh, I saw that earlier.
I was like, oh man, that is.
Oh, and that's cool.
But then you're like, holy shit, that's kind of true.
That's the haircut where the women have the nails like an inch beyond their tip, their fingertip, where they're like really pointy and sharp. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm talking
about,
right?
That shit's terrifying, yeah.
Yeah, claw me to death.
Let's jump in and do some Would You Rather.
What's the worst thing that can happen?
Quite a bit. That's the best part.
You can either snort cayenne pepper or get Tabasco sauce in your eye.
This is oddly appropriate.
That is. It's weird.
That
right?
is.
This was meant
so,
to be.
So cayenne up the nose or Tabasco in the eye?
Yes.
I'll do cayenne up the nose.
I'm going to trust his opinion on this. Because he is an expert, and I feel like you've essentially done both
no,
of
I
those.
Haven't, but...
You've done...
I would
a
rather,
lesser equivalent of both
I would rather
of those.
My nose burn than my eye.
That's true.
I feel like you're less likely to permanently damage something by snorting cayenne
yes.
pepper.
Yeah.
Like and salt,
feel like you
salt's pretty bad.
I feel like you fuck with your eyes pretty badly. Yeah, so snorting salt seems terrible.
I did. Well, we used to do pixie sticks back in high school, too. That was horrible. That was
yeah.
stupid.
You've snorted Smarties.
That's true.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was a terrible idea. Yeah, no. Oh, now that I think about it. Oh, it burns like fire.
Yeah, we were in like fourth grade.
Yeah,
oh,
something
geez.
Like that. Yeah.
God, we were idiots. We're still idiots.
That's young Scarface.
That's what I thought. I thought Smarties were like, when I was young, I was like, I need to take my medication for the day. Let me take my Smarties.
I hate the Smarties.
They're horrible.
All right, what we got next? Anything interesting?
It's a long one.
Oh, God.
All right, we're listening.
And odd. You can... You could be considered really sexy after someone gets to know you, but you're not actually very good looking. Or you could be considered good looking at first glance, but you're not really very sexy after someone gets to know you.
That's so deep.
Well, okay. So it's okay. So for girls, it's not always about looks, but the looks are what draw you in. So that's kind of,
I guess I'd like to be perceived like, over time.
If you look like Toro, girls aren't coming up to you unless he takes pictures of you, so.
Shots fired. Shots fired.
Bang, bang.
But you know what I'm saying? Like, I guess in the long run, you'd want to be perceived as sexy or whatever. You'd want to be.
I don't like that word.
Yeah, it is kind of weird saying.
It's a weird word.
Would you want to be perceived attractive over time, or would you like to initially seem attractive and then no longer?
I think this question is better worded. Would you rather date an insanely hot chick who's a cold fish in bed, or would you rather date a homely chick who's dynamite in bed?
That's still tough. But
I think that's a better version of that question.
I've had more hot girls who are dead fish than homely girls who are hot in bed.
That's fair. I'm not saying I'm not saying either is more of a likely scenario. I'm just saying in this would you rather, you can go one way or another. You got to date a girl who's smoking hot, but
I'd rather have the homely girl because at least I know there's less of a chance of her going running around with other guys.
That's a fair thing to consider.
And because it's vice versa.
She might be grateful
for
it.
It's vice versa with a really attractive guy because you know how girls are crazy. They'll be like, mm-hmm. Well, he's so hot. Like, all these girls are going to be clinging themselves to him if I'm not around him. And then they're scared that you're going to cheat on them. And then they get all paranoid. And that's never good.
That's very true. I've always thought that life would be really easy if you didn't mind banging ugly chicks. Think about how much your options would open. Like, you know.
Man, ugly people got it made.
You wouldn't need as much of a personality.
Jesus. Okay. Would you rather bob for apples in a bucket of urine?
Oh, God.
Right,
the
you're
or?
Immediately like, what's the other one?
Yeah, please.
Or you can bob for live bullfrogs in a bucket of champagne.
I'll do the bullfrogs.
That's a lot to consider. When we first like when I found these things and I thought this would be a great idea, I had no idea like how tough some of these.
Like, nope. I just figured not even double thinking. The bullfrogs.
Is it my piss?
Yeah.
If it's my piss,
is that
piss,
really that big a factor?
Yes. If it's my piss, I'll go that.
Your piss.
If it's someone else's
you're
piss,
for the apples,
I'm going bullfrog.
The piss bucket. But if it's somebody else's piss, yeah. See, I think the bullfrog thing is easy till you get a hold of one.
Yeah,
like,
I feel
you
like
grab a fucking.
It didn't say you had to get one.
Teeth?
It just said you go bob.
Well, you keep bobbing
well,
until
you
get
have,
one.
Yeah, exactly.
God, there's even new layers.
Because otherwise, it's just, would you rather put your head in a bucket of champagne or a bucket of piss? Which doesn't
seem much harder. I'll still do the bullfrog.
Stick with it.
Yeah.
Oh, stay the course.
Yeah.
Grab that bullfrog.
Man. Although you do have to open your mouth to get the apple.
I won't even like put the bullfrog on my lips where it's like hanging out. I'll just put the whole thing in my mouth so it can't get away. And then I'll just spit it
it's
out.
It's a live
it
bullfrog.
You
say
that like
your,
that's
you can't
easy.
Use your hands.
No. I'm saying like I'll just open my mouth until it goes in my mouth, and I'll just.
You're assuming it's a bullfrog that goes into your mouth.
How big are bullfrogs?
They can't
like
be like the size
big.
Of a softball.
Are they that big?
Some of them.
Well, I'll go for the small one.
Find a small. He's like, well, what size bullfrogs are we talking here?
No, I think I made the decision as soon as I realized that I would have to open my mouth to grab the apple. Like, I think dunking my head in a bucket of piss sounds awful, but it's not that bad until I have to open my mouth and my mouth fills with piss. It's the bullfrog.
Hey, is this the kind of urine where there's been a lot of beer through the system or a lot of water and it's not yellow?
Yeah.
How hydrated was I filled this bucket of piss?
Do I get to pre-prep for this? Do I get to just like drink nothing but, you know, just pound water for 3 days?
And well, then... we know what Bear Grylls would say.
That's
oh,
true.
Oh, God.
He'd go piss every time.
That was harder than I thought it would be.
That's what she said.
Ba-dum-tsh.
Ooh, this is dark.
Dark ones make me uncomfortable.
You see,
that's what she said?
You see an inch. Can't get right. Upon seeing an injured animal on the side of the road, you can drive by knowing it is going to die in pain and misery. Or you can drive over it and put it out of its misery immediately.
Put it out of its misery. I've done it before.
I'm driving by. I'm not getting chunks of fucking animal in my car.
Well, no, I
forgot you don't have empathy.
I have no empathy. Yeah.
There was a possum dying years ago, and I had a baseball bat in my car, so we got out and struck it over its head to put it out of its misery.
You're just a psychopath.
Well, I let my friend do it, luckily, so I didn't have to, but I still didn't want it to suffer. Even though it's a freaking possum, but still.
Those are some horrifying animals.
Yeah.
Possum.
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't know. That's always something that's really gotten to me is animal suffering, even though I eat them.
I caught a mouse on a glue trap one day, and you can't, like, get them off of it, or at least if there's a way, I don't really know how. And it's, like, seems really awful because they're, like,
kind of
fucking
limbs
stuck
off
to
or
it.
Something.
Yeah. So I was like, all right, well, I should put it out of its misery, but I didn't want to, like, hit it with a hammer or something because that seems really brutal. I was like, I guess I'll drown it. So, like, I got a bucket of water and I, like, drowned the mouse. And, like, it's a really weird feeling to watch something drown like that. Like, you could see it start to, like, pull in water. And like,
was the trap like a sheet of paper with, like, glue on it? Yeah. Which you should have done is just got the scissors and cut around it until it just had little
glue
shoes.
Rums around.
It had little glue shoes. So then it's for the rest of its life, its feet are on the glue things, but it's got shoes. So if it goes on any rocks, it doesn't hurt.
It was like the whole side of its body.
Damn it.
Its head. It was like,
I was really hoping for the glue shoes.
Yeah, no, that'd have been, I like where your head's at.
It gets like a Phantom of the Opera mask out of glue trap.
Just the whole side of the mouse is covered in cardboard.
So one time I was walking out to my car and some of the neighborhood kids walk up and were asking for help. And they had a baby bird that was stuck to a glue trap.
Ugh.
For some reason, they had put glue traps outside of their house and caught a baby bird on it and were asking for help. And it had torn all the down feathers off of it. And I'm like, there's nothing I can do here. And like you try to like grab it and it would bite at your hand. I was like, I don't know what to do here. And then we have this one crazy lady that wanders around the cul-de-sac a lot. And she made it her life mission to save this bird. And she dragged me along for the experience. And I had to waste like 45 minutes until I could like slink away while she was dealing
with
it.
Was this a farm?
How did she see?
This was right out here.
Because the only time people put glue traps outside are for like flies on farms.
Yo, it wasn't like those kind. It was like a mouse trap.
What was her plan to save the bird?
I don't. She's insane. She didn't have a plan. She's probably gonna like send it off to meet Xenu or something. Like, this lady is crazy.
I just imagine like you guys just like. It seemed like a scene from a movie where, like, there's a hurt animal and somebody's like, go get the witch doctor. Like, go get the crazy lady who lives on the mountain. Like,
yeah, she just wandered over and like, got involved. The kids wandered off, and then I'm stuck here with this bird on a glue.
It was just the two of you?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Me and the crazy lady holding with this glue-trapped baby bird.
That's the house that you make your child stay away from when he gets older.
Yeah.
Yeah.
and then you just like slinked away, ran away, not mm-hmm. really sure how it ever resolved.
I was like, well, good luck with that. She's like, well, I'm gonna and I just like book it, like cross it, hopped in my car and drove off. I was like,
well, hello,
I'm not
young child. Would you like to come to my house for some candy?
Oh God.
There's certainly no person-sized glue traps inside.
That's probably what she did. She still has that bird
Dad,
to this day.
Dad, why is this glue trap stuck into my face?
Dad, I have glue trap shoes.
All right, what a... We got another deep one, or what?
No, I'm just trying to read it to get it in my head. Okay, so you're a woman. You can either be a part-time hooker. No, be a woman isn't one half of the equation.
George is like,
yeah,
done.
Whatever the other one is. You, as a woman, you can either be a part-time hooker or a male escort's habitual customer.
What?
Yeah, now you know why I read it twice. So you can either be a hooker sometimes or you can go to the same male escort a lot.
So
I guess the same? I feel like that's loose. I mean, they're all
but
it all
depends on ratios. Like, are you banging like 10 strangers to like the same guy 10 times or the same guy like 30 times?
So you're having the same amount of sex.
Oh, but it's different partners compared to one person.
That's right.
That's an easy then.
Yeah,
and you get
same.
And you get paid
the same amount
for one of them.
Oh, that's an easy one. I'd rather go to the same guy all the time
that you pay for.
Oh, I pay for him.
He's an escort.
No. Isn't it? I thought you were the escort.
You're a male escort's habitual customer.
So you get paid to have sex
either,
with multiple people.
Or you pay to have sex with the same guy.
Oh, I'll get paid. I'll get railed out by a bunch of guys.
You heard it here first. George Santor wants to get railed out by a bunch of guys. We can cut that in for our intro. No context whatsoever. What are you checking?
I was looking at what time it was. It's like hour 8, maybe.
Yeah,
as long as they wear condoms.
Oh, God. So, you could either get paid to get railed out by a bunch of guys or pay to get railed out by the same guy over and over and over again.
There's no guarantee that that guy is any better than these other random people that are paying.
Statistically, he should be better than some of them.
If he's
true.
Making money, though, no, if he's charging, and he's an ass, so.
I don't know.
I also wonder about the dollar. I also wonder about the dollar ratio. So do you get $50 each time you get railed out by another guy, or you pay $50 to get railed out every time you want sex? Is it the same in-out ratio? Because now you love money.
I do love money. I love money. It's a fucking idiocracy.
These damn cards need to be more descriptive.
Yeah, that we have questions.
Yeah.
We have questions and need answers. Yeah. these cards simply do not provide.
Call up the Would You Rather 800 number. We're going to need clarification on card 167, question 5. How good looking is the male escort?
Like, that'd be great if they had like...
How big's his dick?
Like further reading on the back. Like it's got a backstory for each question.
His dick is big, but not too big.
It's like, all right.
All right. We're in the right zone.
That helps our team out figure out what we would rather do. So
these are the important questions that we're asking on Last Call Podcast.
Can I be choosy about my clients? Like, or do I just have to stand on a street corner and just like, take any fucking truck driver who can scrounge together $15. What's my rate? There are questions.
We need to know these things.
Yeah.
We can't adequately
considering the fact I live in the prostitution capital of Maryland, as Josh Spiegel puts it. Laurel, Maryland, horrible on prostitution. It's really bad. They've been working on it a little bit, but
is that connected to the running over the animal to put it out of its misery thing? I feel like those can be connected.
Start running over hookers.
You just like run her over, just like, honey, you just need to end it, and I'm here to help.
Oh my God,
that would be my empathy. I'll run over hookers for fun.
Just go out late at night. Just how many can I save?
Yeah, that's it. I'm safe, honey. Going out, gotta save some hookers.
Now it's getting too serious right now because not to be too serious for a moment, but that one guy just went to trial for he had this teenage girls that he found on, or he put on the back page, and he was hooking them out, and they were prostitutes.
What?
And he just got busted a year ago, and he just went. I think court started like a week ago or something like that.
Wait, was
he
that was, around here?
He was. It was. yeah, it was in Jessup at the truck stop area. This guy was hooking out like two 16-year-old girls that he was keeping pretty much captive and hooking them out.
That's terrible.
And he got busted because the cops put something on Backpage, and he went on there, and he thought it was another like 16-year-old girl, and he went to go meet up with them and got busted.
Like,
believe it or not, Howard County for prostitution and guys getting younger girls and pretty much making them hook themselves out, it's horrible. It's gotten really bad, especially that whole Jessup truck stop area. If you do research, or you're even just friends on Facebook of Howard County Police Department, the stuff you learn, it is bad, man.
I mean, when you said all that and then you followed it with Jessup truck stop,
yeah,
it all seemed to make sense in my head.
Yeah, it's that area. But see, what it was for a while was the prostitution's bad at the truck stop, and then when they got busted there, they would move up my way at Route 1 and Whiskey Bottom, and then when they got busted there, they would go back down to the they would pretty much go back and forth, and it's been like that for years. So it's just, but it, I mean, there's one thing, there's hooking, and then there's guys forcing teenage girls to hook.
That's a whole different level.
Yeah, yeah, it's ugh. Just like put that guy on the.
What a crazy world we live in. Like, I don't even think about these things.
We had a story we wanted to do. It was weeks ago. So it was about a woman, and she went on to Craigslist, and she posted an ad that said, "I'm really into rape fantasy. What I really want somebody to do is just to come to the house and kick the door in, and even if I say no, keep doing it." Do you know this story?
No, I don't know this story, but I can assume.
Strap in.
Yeah.
So, I want somebody to kick the door in, even if I say no. You know, take me. You know, you have my consent. Like, please, somebody come do this. So, I think somebody came, and did they come do it, or did they attempt?
They basically attempted to, and I think it pretty much happened.
Is this local?
No, this was in like California.
Okay.
So somebody came and they did it, and then she called the police and said, "I didn't put this fucking ad up. I don't know who did."
Oh no.
This somebody has played an awful joke, goes in, gets tests done, all kinds of stuff. Somebody did this to me. So the cops go into full investigation mode, and they start doing digital forensics on the ad and stuff like that. And what they find is that the girl's the girl has a boyfriend, and his ex-girlfriend had put up the ad for her to get her raped.
That is dirty.
So then prosecution begins on this woman who has put up this fake rape ad for her ex-boyfriend's new girlfriend.
There's a sentence you never thought you'd say.
Yeah.
The investigation continues, and thankfully somebody was doing their job because they start to notice anomalies about some of the forensic details. And what they find is that it wasn't the ex-girlfriend who put up the ad. It was the original girl who put it up to frame the ex-girlfriend.
No shit.
She put up a rape ad for herself to get raped to make the ex-girlfriend look bad.
Couldn't they have found that off by the IP just to begin with?
That's the path that they eventually went down. Like, I think what had happened was, I think the new girlfriend had some login information for the ex. Like, there was a Facebook login or something like that. So she had used that information to post the ads. So initially it looked like that's where it came from. And then when they started tracking down IPs and location, they found that it was.
She would have been smart to just buy a burner phone with like internet on it and done it through that. That's your best bet nowadays.
I think there are probably a lot of ways.
George is like, when I put up rape ads.
Well, no. I'm just thinking it because I've been watching that show Hunted, and a lot of people on the show Hunted are using burner phones, which is smart. Have you guys seen that show?
Dude,
that show's amazing.
It's based on The Running Man.
Yeah, pretty much. But they're idiots. I think I would do great on that show. I would go to Tent City where it's a bunch of homeless people. I would just set up shop. I would panhandle for a couple weeks. Good to go.
Three, maybe 4 years.
But it's still reality
ago.
Television. You know half of it's set up.
Oh, anyway. Without a doubt.
3, maybe 4 years ago, I read Stephen King's Running Man short story. I was like, this is really interesting. You could make this a modern day television show. And I went to all of my friends and I was like, I just read The Running Man, and look, The Running Man's ridiculous, but I think you could make, and not the movie Running Man, right? Stephen King's Running Man is like, there's a guy, and you're the running man now, and if you make it 30 days, you get $1 billion or something.
Yeah, this is 28 days, you get $250,000.
But anybody in the country who sees you can report you, and they get $100,000 for reporting it. And so the entire country is into this. Now everybody's going to hunt you, right? And there's a team of dedicated hunters who are going to hunt you down. I was like, this would make a good real TV show. So I went to all my friends and my family. I was like, I think I have a great idea. This should be a fucking TV show. And they were like, nah, that sounds kind of fucking stupid. And now fucking ABC's got a hit new reality show.
If you had said that to me, I would have been like, yeah, we should get this.
Man, I thought it was the best idea. So, like, what are the rules? So, like, these people, do they have to move?
It's 9 teams. You have to be within, it's Northern Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, and parts of Alabama. And if you make it 28 days, you get $250,000. And they're dirty. I mean, I don't want to ruin or spoil any of the show, but there's definitely a few people. It's only 4 episodes now. But there's definitely been someone who's been busted because of a family member. There's definitely been someone who's been busted because they used their debit card at a certain spot. There's a couple people that are smart.
And so you're supposed to not have any resources?
You need to be off the grid as much as possible. But there's a couple people who are like, well, I'm going to go to friends' houses. Or I'm going to go to family members' houses. Or I'm going to go here. But what they do is they go into your house and they get your computers. It's CIA intelligence.
There's a hunting team
that
CIA
are actually people who have done it for their career. They know what they're doing. And I mean, they pretty much do protocol as if this was an actual manhunt. And it's so cool, the things that they go through. And, I mean, they're finding the friends and the family down. If it's anyone connected, they're putting traces on their friends' phones. So if you call them, you're busted. So they're getting, like, burner phones. And they'll call them once and the phone's gone, that kind of stuff. But they're idiots because they're going to their friends' houses. And I'm just like, no. I'll go off the grid. I won't talk to anyone. I won't do anything. So there's these two guys.
Wait, how long do you have to last?
28 days. There's these two college kids, and they're like, yo, boys. They're like preppy boys, and they go to like the beach in South Carolina, and their whole plan is to like go to the beach, talk to girls, hit on girls, and crash at their house for the night or whatever, you know, for a couple days at a time. And they're pretty successful. I'm not going to say what happens, but like they're pretty successful, and I'm like, I just want them of all people to lose. But when it comes to like day 12 or 13 – they put all over social media a reward out. They're like, these two people they're wanted because they volunteered themselves in a game show, and they put a reward out. And that's when people are starting to see it, and they're like, and then that's when, like, do you turn them in or not? So, like I said, I don't want to spoil anything. Definitely worth a watch.
I got to check that shit out.
Yeah, it's fucking cool.
That could have been you hosting that show.
I didn't even want to host it. I just wanted to get paid for it. I thought it was a great
idea. Yeah.
Let's just go in that region and just catch people.
Oh, that's true. Just go hunt them. That sounds like more fun anyway.
All right, kids. Well, we've reached the end of our Black Jafar sand. That's our timer. Maybe I was missing. Thank you very much to everybody for joining us. Thank you, Tristan, for hosting this with me as always. Thank you, George, for joining.
You're very welcome.
We'll see y'all next time on the next Last Call.
See ya.
Later.
Would you rather have a have a fully functional penis attached to your forehead or no penis at all?
I would rather have a penis forehead.
Now here's
forehead penis.
Now does that mean that's your only penis?
Yeah.
Is the one on your forehead?
Yeah.